stuff that didn't get published because.
Oh, there's all sorts of, I mean, that's an entire discipline in and of itself.
The problem is that we have this with government funding.
Works that were either tried to be destroyed by the compulsory warrant, or ones that have been discovered later and weren't there. Lots of those composers would make sure that before they died, they knew they were important, they would destroy everything that they did. Because they knew posterity would want it.
But then we could give you a donation.
Oh, yeah.
To the department or something.
Really crazy. They also said that I read some letters. I don't know if I'd really, nowadays, it'd be interesting to see if we have all this digital knowledge, you know, about 200 years, are they gonna be able to look at our text messages if we got famous, that would study it, that would be pretty horrible. That's kind of, in a way, what we're doing by going through that letter, so.
I would want to spend my life erasing things.
Fun.
I mean, it's not gonna be this whole, it's not gonna be this whole book that you're.
So yeah, you bring up lots of interesting points that could be an entire class actually on how classical music works and the education system.
Well, I go to parties and we talk about these things.
Yeah, that's great, yeah, exactly.
I do have to do it.
Really interesting thought.
Because I think that would be a pain in the butt.
It won't be a pain in the butt if that helps. But I'll work on, I do want you to be able to use this material, you know, the best that you can, so I'll start working on that.
Okay, but I understand how you have, if it's a grant, then you have to keep it in the building.
Yeah.
If someone comes through, you're.
If it were just my money that I raised on my own.
Yep.
That would not be a problem.
Where did you get the grant from, the arts?
No, it's from the National Institutes of Health.
Of Health?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, because you're here.
Yeah.
Cool.
That's where I submitted the grant to about it.
Excellent.
Are you guys gonna use this?
What's that? They are? Oh, cool. I did get it, yeah, I was like, oh, got it, yeah.
Okay, use this.
Everyone can do that, but we're not ever.
Wait, what's the?
Oh, golly.
Oh, you are gonna use this board? I'll just let you decide.
I was trying to find the. Yeah, VPN, that's what I'm using. I thought I would just type in, it comes up on that.
Friday. Hi. Alrighty, how are you guys?
Good.
Beautiful day outside. One important thing about pianists is we can't take our instrument outside and play in the sun. Kirsten can sing outside in the sun, violins can go outside and play, see guitars practicing outside all the time. Okay, we just pull out the grand staff paper that you started taking notes on and drawing. Yes, that one. No,
grand staff.
The grand staff paper.
That's just a worksheet with.
Yes, that one. Yeah, so we had drawn some landmark notes on there on what Monday. Because we would fold what you wrote over so you can't see your words.
Quiz time.
Yeah, so just fold it over so you can't see your own writing. And I want you to go ahead and see if you can draw a middle C in the treble clef. The treble G, the treble C. So we have, six landmark notes, even though middle C is the same.
For which four?
So we need
middle C,
treble C,
treble G.
Treble G, middle C in both the clefs.
Okay, yeah.
Because they look slightly different. I just where they're placed. And then bass F and bass C.
Yeah, I thought of my own.
Yeah.
done, go ahead and open up your notes and see if you remember correctly. If not, just take a look to see what was wrong.
Which one?
Which one's base C?
The base C?
Guys.
That's the base clef.
Oh, I see.
But it's also in the middle.
B2, so as you're moving down this way, you're moving to the left of your keyboard.
That's the treble C?
Down is down.
And then base D is down.
You're going down, right, unless I'm reading up, then the notes do go up. So, we're thinking this is the left side of your keyboard.
Exactly.
This is the right side. So like from bottom to top, low sound, high sound.
Let's see. Would that be C?
So, A, oh, I'm sorry, I said it's C.
Who needs help? Who wants another set of eyes?
Oh, those are.
Space, right?
Yeah.
Y.
Right.
Yeah.
And then C is this.
What is it?
Oh, I'm sorry. Does that make sense?
Right, you see something different.
That's fixed, got it.
Got it, okay.
Nailed it. We're checking out the, the staff. Oh, no, don't worry about it, we're not checking.
I spent a lot of time on the homework and I didn't get that.
Okay, so if you're looking at your own. If you made the run, it's moving fast.
It does move very fast.
It's totally fine, because it's gonna take practice to place them in the correct spot. So if you were somewhere went wrong, just double check the association, so you remember where it is.
You try to.
You may or may not be able to get on Friday. Alright? Yes, so just put that off to the side, we're gonna do some more work with it. Alrighty, so let's name some of these notes. Okay, I'm just gonna be playing them. You'll see them on the visualizer.
Okay, so we get those lights.
Yeah, okay. So I'm gonna go around, I'm just gonna pick on people.
Lizzie.
Where'd you go?
You gotta get a name, right? Name for that.
What?
Yep, what note is that?
I have no idea.
Okay. Wow. What letter is this?
G.
Oh,
G?
G, yes. Be specific, we're going to call it treble G.
Okay.
It's this guy right here. Alright. Dominic.
Middle C.
Yes.
Oh,
Dominic.
Bass F.
Very good. Jane.
Treble G.
Mac.
Nancy.
Nancy Bell.
Jane.
Treble G.
Helen.
Yes, very good. Catherine.
Middle C.
Catherine. Yep, you again.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I don't know.
Middle of Basie.
Basie, right, because you knew this middle C, and now we're just going lower. Basie, right? So Catherine, what was this top of the B? You again.
Treble D.
Treble C.
Treble C. Yes. Try some middle C. Do you see how far these are?
Yeah, they're all C.
And these ones are
somewhat
closer. And then the C's are far apart from the middle C. Yeah? Again, we're just looking at associations. How far are they from one another? Marsha.
Treble C.
Yeah. Verlis.
Base.
G?
Treble G.
Darlene?
Treble C.
Renee? Susanna?
Treble G.
Nancy Ball?
Middle C.
Nancy Bell?
Thanks,
Nancy Ball?
Treble, sorry.
Nancy Bell?
Middle C.
Cool. That was more for me. I just wanted to know who was what. Pauline?
Bass F.
And Helen?
Treble T.
Excellent. All right, so now you guys are seeing it and be able to react to it. You know what to call them. Let's see if you can find them on the keyboard. All right, so go ahead and slide your lips open. Unplug your headphones.
Unplug?
Unplug.
Yeah, for those of you who were here before, they might have been plugged in.
Okay, boss.
Sure.
This lesson we're doing now, where is that in the book?
Here, everybody.
Is there a thing that shows?
There are a couple of different spaces. This is
good. Alrighty.
So this is the showing the...
Okay, so what I'm going to do, I'm going to call on one person. That person's going to play that note for me, and then everybody's going to play. One person, everybody. One person, everybody. Marsha, we can play treble G.
Cool.
Excellent. Everybody, treble G. Catherine, middle C. Okay, good. I was to make sure that was your piano that I was hearing. Now, everybody.
Oops.
Jane, let's do bass F. Good, everybody. Excellent. Verlis, treble G. Everybody. Ooh, someone's too low. Be careful. Treble G, make sure you are above middle C. Middle C, Helen. Yeah, your piano is the one that goes really, really loud, surprises everybody. Everybody, middle C. Good. Bass F. Max. Good. Everybody? Good. Double check to make sure you are below middle C. And play that bass F again. Good. Let's do bass C, Paul.
No, bass C.
Good. You caught yourself and suddenly, oh, oh. Good, so everyone's on top of it. Bass C, everybody.
Bass C.
Bass C. Yes. Alright. Treble C, Pauline.
Oh.
There you go. Everybody treble C. Everybody middle C. Everybody bass C. Middle C. Treble C. Bass C. My mind and getting to the note before I ask for it. Middle C. Be careful, middle C. There it is. Bass C. Treble C. Be careful, center's in the middle. Double check. Slightly to the right of center of your keyboard. Middle C. Far apart. So I'm just gotta be able to jump and react to whether it's treble or bass. Okay? Alright. Let me just open your books to page 49.
Go ahead.
Sorry. That's fun?
Yeah, that's
good. We'll do more of it.
Oh, yeah.
Gotta keep you on your toes. Alright, so looking at the examples on page 49. Look at number 7.
Oh, man.
Take a look at number 7. Marsha asked a good question. She said, I see things, they look different, right? So, yes, my notes are moving up.
Where's my other board?
So, Marsha saw the note heads moving up. Here, I'm in my bass clef. What note did I just drop?
Bass C.
Bass C. Excellent. We see the note heads moving up. There's no question about that, right?
Stepping, right.
Space, mm-hmm. line, moving our way up. But then you see this.
Yeah.
This is going up. This is going down.
Mm-hmm.
It does not matter. It does not change what note you are playing. Okay. This is a aesthetical thing, if you will. I don't know what else to call it. Right. So what it is, if you are on this middle line or below, you are going to draw your stem going up. If you're on this middle line or above, your stem goes down on the left side.
So it's just aesthetics.
It's just aesthetics. Right, because think about this. If you have your notes going up, they're just trying to keep everything within your five lines. So your stems don't start moving into the treble clef area. Mm. They're just trying to keep things more compact within your five lines. They do not change what note it is, doesn't change the note value either. It just looks better. Right? But it's up on the right side, down on the left side.
And that's, and that sometimes you may see, that's not always a hard and tried rule that it always goes up and down the same place. Like you're saying, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter.
Yeah. Just ignore them. Okay. All right. So these examples, you may have played through them. Maybe you got through all of them. Maybe not. We'll get through all of them today. All right. But I see notes. I see what kind of note I need to play and which ones to play. But otherwise, it's not very musically interesting because there's nothing else on the page. They're just notes. All right, so we're going to make things a little bit more interesting. And so we're going to be talking about dynamics. We've done a little bit with it, meaning when you were playing Amazing Grace, be a little bit more gentle on the keyboard so you sound softer and it fits the mood of Amazing Grace. All right? So, if you're playing something that is soft, you would have a nice little cursive P, and that stands for piano. And this is a sound volume, it's not the instrument that you're playing. Okay? So funnily enough, we call this our instrument now the piano, but actually the full name is forte. Piano forte. Okay, so literally, what they shorten it to, so with the pianoforte, is describing an instrument that can play soft and loud. And indeed, our instrument can play soft and loud. That's where that name comes from. All right. So that would mean if you were to play something loud, you would mark a F next to it. So loud, soft. Those are two very basic ones. Sometime last week, Josh did mention when we were doing our pentascales, we shape the way we go on the keyboard. So when we went up, when I went up just now, what happens to this sound? I get louder on my way up, and then on my way down, it's always louder. That's a very natural way that music happens. You can try it the other way, and it's sometimes it happens in music, but it just goes against our natural instinct to go. It's doable, but I have to fight it a little bit to do it. I think really hard to play loud to soft when I'm going up the keyboard. Alright, so when we go, when we want to grow louder, we have this lovely thing. Who remembers what the music term is for getting louder? Yeah, good. And this is on the recap sheet from last week. So we have crescendo. So what would be the opposite?
Decrescendo.
I also hear diminuendo. They are synonyms. So sometimes a composer might actually write this entire word, or they might do a shorthand of the word, or they might use the symbol to show you how much they want you to get louder. Okay. And then same thing here, use a shorthand, either that or D-I-N. Right. So we're going to put some dynamic markings in this little playing example. So have your pencils ready. If you don't have one,
I have some of those to write in this one.
With pencil. Go ahead and do it.
You can do it with pencil.
We're determining what's happening.
Yeah.
So taking a look at example one.
So it's going.
You okay?
Getting a little more cold as well.
You can use pen for this.
Oh, I have little golf pencils here.
Oh,
that's good.
I may have pencils in my bag actually too.
I have an action pencil.
Oh, you got your pencil.
I don't want to just go all over again. Okay. All right, so with example one, first of all, Renee, do you want to start that or do you want to start stop?
You are.
Stop, okay, so go, everyone go ahead and put a cursive P right in between your grand staff, right between your treble clef and bass clef.
What?
A cursive what?
Cursive P, representing P for piano, which means stop.
In the beginning, the first bar, the first measure?
Yeah, the example lesson one, right below middle C.
Okay.
So we're going to start soft, and then we can keep it all soft, or we can get louder from soft.
Yeah, so we can go like that then.
So we can draw, what's that mean?
Yeah.
Crescendo. Okay. Yeah, so instead of making gesture, we're going to start putting music terms to it. All right?
So then you make it for the next two notes then, or you just put it little?
So we have options, don't we? Okay, so we have C. D, E, we can crescendo to that half note, and then we can do another crescendo, E, F, G, and we can end up on forte by the time we get there. Does that sound pretty good?
Okay, so where do
you do that?
So here we go, about the places.
Is it thought of the measure? Right here, tell yourself to do a crescendo. Essentially do this. Tell yourself to crescendo all the way up to
G.
Okay.
So you do the line all the way to where you want to go?
Yeah, exactly. Okay, cool. So you can extend that crescendo to the point that you want it.
You put it in that middle part?
So you always see it in between your treble clef and bass clef.
Okay.
Let's play through that one. So which hand are we going to be using?
Right hand.
In your treble clef. We do have note values, so let's keep this nice and steady. One, two, I'll give you two bars. One, two, three, four. One, two, really soft. Heard a couple. All right. That's okay, let's try it again. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four.
Soft.
And then crescendo in one measure, And then decrescendo in the second measure.
Does all written music necessarily include those, the P and the F, or does it, is it intuitive? Do they leave
great
it up to
question.
The,
if you look at the music of Bach, there are no Danielis Magde anywhere. Because his instrument was a harpsichord. If you ever heard a harpsichord, it sounds all the same to me. All the time. Right? But now that we play Bach's music on the piano, on an instrument that can have dynamic variations, then the pianists, their interpretation of it, we do have a lot of crescendos and decrescendos. Just the way music is shaped.
But like modern music?
This part is called the measure, right?
Yes.
So the first measure, we're going to start soft and then crescendo. And then the second measure of number five, we're going to decrescendo.
Mm-hmm. You bet.
Okay.
Yeah.
So like this. Is dynamics an evolution of music?
I don't think so, because in choral music, we've had these markings around even choral music that Bach has written. But there's a bit of, personal interpretation of what piano and forte are and the range in between. So editors will add in their own dynamics sometimes, so the people publishing the music. And then musicians themselves might specify dynamics a little bit differently.
Okay.
Right, because with the crescendo and decrescendo, it's all relative, right? So if I start, that's pretty loud, but I can still do a crescendo on top of that. Not on this piano, though. I can still get louder even though I started loud, right? So depending on where you're at, you can still crescendo, and then you can decrescendo to something that's not quite as loud, right? And so for composers that get more specific, then you have in between, so from piano, then we get something called mezzo piano. Mm. Right? Because music has a lot of gradations, and then you get this, and then you get this. Mm. Right? It just keeps going.
Very, very loud?
Very, very, very loud, which is a very ugly sound. And then almost inaudible. I have seen new music that the composers will put four P's in. Why even bother? I can't even hear myself. But they do it. Right? So it's all depends on where you are. So, you know, I can crescendo from here to here. That would be true. Or I can crescendo from here to here. Right? Or from, that would also be a crescendo. Because I'm just gradually getting slightly louder with all of these.
One more thing with that. Yeah, I think it's important to say that not every crescendo though will be notated in the score. So sometimes you would have a long period of a piano dynamic marking, and it's expected that you would do shaping within that of up and down.
So right now, so by looking at these notes, I can see them going up and coming back down. So we're just being a little bit more literal. Let's make sure that because the notes are going up, our sound goes with it. Alright, let's try number five. Alright, so we step up in measure one, and then what do we do in measure two?
Step down.
Go down.
We do go down, but we don't step down. We skip down. Go line, line, line on the way down. We go two measures.
One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. D.
Ready, play. Wow. Okay, both measures. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Exercise, but it's a beautiful standing exercise, and that's what we want. Okay, let's do. Let's do 7. Let's do 1 in the base clap.
Haven't been there.
Great. Say hello to base clap land. That very first note. What is it, Dominic?
C.
C. C. Base C.
Again, I get a lot of Dominics. What's your first note in number 7?
Bass C.
Yes, that's the, one of our landmark notes. Okay. So then, are we stepping up or skipping up?
Stepping up.
Line, so space, line, space, line, space.
Line, space.
Perfect. We're going up the keyboard, so how about let's push all notes. So what's the lowest note you need in this example? It's bass C. What's the highest note you need?
Bass G.
Sure, yes, we can call it bass G, definitely. So we have a C. So we need 5 notes. So naturally you have 5 fingers, so I'm going to make sure you start with your fifth finger on bass C. So you don't run out of fingers. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. C, D, E, F. Now we're going to try the way that I said it. We're going to fight our instincts a little bit, okay? Your first note is going to be loud and then get softer. Let's see how that feels. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. It was a great decrescendo, but does it feel slightly more awkward than natural? For some, maybe, right? For me, yes, I always have to kind of fight it a little bit. But that is also very reasonable to do a decrescendo on that example. Okay. Number 8. Check your skips and your steps.
Skipping.
All of it?
Stepping down.
Number 8. There we go. Okay. Let's crescendo going up. Crescendo coming down. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Four.
turn it into a half note?
I did turn it into a half note.
Okay. So what is that? How would you explain what that symbol does? That
little it ties two quarter notes together.
It ties it together.
Two different measures.
That's why we need a tie. I can't put a half note there because then I would have 5 beats in a measure. It doesn't work. So if composers want the half note right there, but they're running into a bar line, they'll use a tie. So we don't ever play the second tie.
So it's 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1. And you have
correct. You just gotta hang over. Yeah.
Just keep doing it.
Count
it out so I have to
remember. Well, I will. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4.
What did you just play? How about just Ruby plays? Number 11. Yeah. And I'll say my hold so you know where I'm holding.
Okay.
1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Hold. 2, 3, 4.
Oh. Okay. What?
So,
or
so
you don't play it a second time.
Not.
Ah. Oh. Okay, so, but in the example, they get two different notes that are slow.
So, in number 11, notice those two notes are both bass F.
Yeah.
So that is a tie. Okay? The first note was a bass F and the second note was something else. That would be a slur. So those are two different things. Same symbol. If your notes are so in this little inset box right here. It looks like a tie, except the notes are different.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Oh. So if they are the same, you simply hold the note over. It makes the note longer.
You hold the first one down as you press the second. On a slur.
Yes, you do. So on a slur, in that little box right there, I see an E and a D.
Where?
Okay. If the slur wasn't there, this is what it would sound like.
Oh, yeah.
But with the slur, it just slightly slurred. Right? So slur will just make our sound. In Amazing Grace, you guys were slurring everything naturally because that's how you heard the song. So you were already doing slurs. This is just what it looks like on paper. Okay. Bar 6. Not bar 6. Number 6. Is that a tie or is that a slur?
It's a tie.
So it is a tie. So with the tie, now it's now that G, that treble G, is worth how many beats?
3.
You got it. Half note plus a quarter note.
Ah, 2 and 1. Mm-hmm. Okay.
You hold it over. Okay, so keep working through all of these. Add your own dynamics in each one so that you start playing around and thinking about it. On your keyboards, it will be a little bit more challenging to do dynamics because your keyboards are not weighted, meaning no matter how hard or how soft you press, it's going to just come up with one sound. But by you thinking about that, I want to play this softer than when you come in here on a real piano, that will translate. So still think about your dynamics, even though your instrument's not responding to you the way you want it to. Okay?
Wait, do those instruments not have touch sensitivity?
No.
No.
It's really easy to play a note you didn't mean to play on this.
Would you be willing to play it through so I can sound if I've been playing it?
On page 49, it's not intended to be played all the way through. Because do you see how they reset the grand staff every time you have something? In a full piece of music, you won't see that.
Okay.
Right, so just play these as one, as small chunks the way they're written. All right. For Friday, we just turn to page 45. So now with reading music, the secret to reading music better is to read more of it. So we're going to give you more to read. Now you have a longer example. You have three examples for your right hand on page 48, three examples for your left hand. I want you guys to meet somebody. Her name is Hilly. She is the author of this book. She is on the website. Okay. So, website is tfppiano.org. Yes, for piano for pleasure, piano.org.
And we want that because?
I'm going to show you right now. So, Renee, what chapter are we on?
Chapter four.
What chapter are we in?
Four.
It is. Great. You guys are actually see the four bottom corners. That's what that four is for. Okay. So you're gonna go under chapter four. There's a lot of good stuff on here. You're actually gonna go to MP3 files. So as you are playing through these examples, they might be right, they might be wrong, you're not sure. So take a look at the MP3 player, and this is Lily. She's going to talk to you.
Reading item one, we're doing the first example, the 3-4 example. Notice the suggested fingering for you to start on G is finger 3. Two bar count off.
What? She's on page 47. Under reading, the first example that you have.
Okay.
All right. And this is what it'll sound like. She's gonna play. Before you start playing, or during, or after, then you'll be able to kind of match up what you're playing with what it should sound like. And you've got a nice little accompaniment underneath it too. Okay.
Can you go back one page just to show how they can find and line up?
Yeah, okay. Let me start over. So we are in PFP Piano. We are in chapter 4. And then you're gonna go select MP3 files. Play along and find the item that you're looking for. Page number, reading, and so the 3.4, that's the only way the computer would register a time signature. Okay, so 3.4. And then the second example in 4.4.
Yeah.
Third example.
Did you send us a link or do you want us to use the old one?
Sure.
To pfppiano.org.
I wrote it up here if you guys want to see that. If it's kind of hard to see it there, so make sure you have a double P.
Which second? Oh, which one are we listening to again? On this, once you get down, from this list up here.
So page 47.
Page 47.
We have three examples on page 47. We have three examples on page 48.
Okay, so we're doing both 47 and 48.
Yeah. So just to get more reading in. It doesn't have to be perfect. The more you read, your brain and fingers will start making those connections. Right? Don't worry about making them perfect. Just gotta play through more of it.
So should we know what sharp and flat is?
If you read page 45 and 46, you will.
So is there a homework include
45, 46, 47, 48.
And 49?
And 49, continue with 49, yes.
So we do all the 47 and 48s in this line.
Mm-hmm. Play through it once or twice. Doesn't need to be perfect. Right? Listen to it, move on, go do something else. Don't kill yourself over these examples.
Good.
Alright. So cover some rhythm with Josh.
It's we're gonna start some things. And one thing with those things, I noticed that Professor Kennedy does a great job, but sometimes the examples do move kind of fast in terms of the tempo. So don't be afraid to do these a few times on your own and then try to work it up the tempo, because she does tend to go kind of fast through them. If that's an issue on me, so I noticed that with them. Actually, we're going to deviate a little bit from the original plan, because I've kind of seen a need to discuss something that hasn't really been discussed. We are going to talk about a big word called articulation today, and I will write that for you. Okay, so I know some of you that's kind of hard to see here. I'm going to use this here for a while. So, articulation. Here's the word, all right? Kind of this long word. Actually, though, it's representing something very fundamental and very important about music, a wide variety of what we call touches, or different lengths of sounds. So, articulation, most generally speaking, we're going to have two ends of the spectrum. So, anybody know? I bet you some of you know the words from these. What if I want to play something really smooth and long? You know what the word for that is? What's that?
It's a French word.
Oh, you got it. Where did you get that? Hell, did you find it somewhere on there? Hey, okay,
what,
good.
What?
She's cheating, but we'll still count it. Okay, so the word is another Latin word. You notice a lot of the composers use Latin for their terminology. Crescendo, crescendo. All those things are from Latin.
Italian.
Another Latin term. What's that?
Italian.
Oh, Italian. I'm sorry. Not Latin. Yeah, not Latin. Yeah, from Italian. Yes. From De Crescendo, Crescendo. And even the German composers use that. So it's just kind of a common term. So legato means smooth or in a connected manner. So let's all just try and play something with legato. Now, all of these things we have to play in kind of a physical way on the keyboard, and that's the evolution that I still work on to this day. So it's a constant process. So don't expect you to this perfectly. It's a matter of coordination, physical things. But generally speaking, if we want to play legato, you want to kind of go into the keys a little bit slowly, and you want to feel a connected manner between your hands on the keyboard. This is a great example because I'm playing like this, but you can kind of see if I'm going to play legato, it's going to be a smooth. And it's kind of a gesture of a single gestural motion to a comprised all five fingers. So I'm going 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And the fingers are kind of connected. And we kind of use the word weight at the piano in order to describe a smooth transfer of weight to the fingers. Now, this is all sorts of technical things. We open up Pandora's box for how we do it. So I don't want you to push the piano. But can we all take your right hand and put it on the middle C? Now, so I put your thumb of your right hand on middle C. Thumb of right hand on middle C. Everybody play that for me, please. Good. And can we just play in a connected manner? Ooh, we have a nice oboe, I think. Yeah, all right, we have a different sound. Yeah. Usually you'd expect them to play in A so we can tune. I know. Okay. The sound is, if you guys are curious then if that ever happens.
Okay.
Sometimes the keys don't push very well.
Thank you.
Okay, push it. Okay. So we are going to play, actually, since we're so good at the staff here, and I'm gonna draw really a little treble clef for you here. Right here, we're gonna play C. D E F G hold. Okay? Going. Oops, actually, let's make that happen if actually that works. And then we'll have it. Okay? And the corresponding thing that we're talking about, that word slur, right? Slur is synonymous with legato. So the touch then would be indicated by this. A slur that encompasses all of these notes. So we would play that in a single slurred legato manner. So notice how in the example you have two notes that are slurred. We actually call that a two-note slur. We'll talk about that later. But this here has then, how many notes? Five notes, yep. All under a continuous slur. So this would be played in what we call a legato manner. Okay, let's try it out. I'm going to give you a two-bar introduction, and we are going to play these notes. Go ahead and sing and say them while you play, if you want. Actually, no, I changed my mind. Let's focus on your fingers. Okay, everybody on middle C with your right hand thumb. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Good, I think someone might be starting on a note lower. Let's try that again. And have a nice C, D, E, F, G. So we're kind of trying to emulate the sound of the voices being smooth. 1, 2, I'm just going to give you one measure. 1, 2, 3, 4. C, E, F, G, 2. Ah, yeah, that's pretty darn good. Can we take your left hand and do the same thing? And let's do it an octave lower. Which means, what kind of a C am I going to be playing if I play one C lower? Bass C, good. And if I'm going to play that bass C here, from the bottom, which space am I going to put that? From the bottom.
Second
from the bottom, right? Reading is always bottom to top in music. You always go bottom to top, bottom to top. Okay? So that would be written C, D, E, F, and G. There we go. And then notice then how the stems can go either way. I'm just going to write them all this way to show your left hand. C, D, E, F, G. And what do I need over that to make it smooth?
Slurring.
Yeah, and what will go from, what is this note?
C.
To?
G.
Good. And what do we call it? Is it called a tire slur?
Slur.
Slur, right? So the slur goes from here to here. Okay, there we are.
How would you play it without the long?
That's a really good question. We're going to get to that in just 1 minute. That's a really excellent question. Like, what is the opposite of this? And we're going to get to that. Yeah, exactly.
But then there's only two?
We're going to get to that too. Good question. Good question. All good question. It's only time will tell, right? Okay. So what finger should we probably use here in the left hand if we want to go up?
Pinky,
right? So we have five notes, five fingers. It won't always be that easy, but in this case, it works out. Because you are working on a bunch of things now that are not easy, right? Reading, articulation, all these wonderful things, but you are learning so much, so I just want you to always give yourself a pat on the back. Yeah? Really, you're doing incredibly well. Okay, let's try this then in a smooth manner. Left hand should be like this. Left hand here, or bass C. I'm going to give you one measure of count in. 1, 2, 3, 4. Let's do that one more time. 1, 2, ready, play. Good. And if you can feel that gesture is kind of a down, can you feel that larger gesture? 1, 2, 3, 4. Or just let me actually say it this way. C, F, G, in a single kind of gesture. And see if you can get that nice and smooth, all right?
Think yeah. about the weight transfer from finger to finger. Mm-hmm. And I literally just thought of this example. Imagine what it feels like to be rolling dough. As you're going from finger to finger, you're pressing as you go, right? So as you switch finger, imagining you're rolling dough.
It's
and your
motion.
Weight will, yes.
Mm-hmm. That's a really good analogy. So just feeling that transfer of weight. Okay? 1, 2, ready, play. Yeah, wonderful. And in the end, what you're going to be using is your ear. That's going to let you determine whether it's smooth or not, how things stick out. So the physical gesture will kind of emulate that. But you can be thinking of this analogy of rolling the dough, something smooth, imagining a voice, you're going to naturally kind of find that right answer. Okay? And we have just enough time. So does anybody know the opposite of fleato? Staccato. All right, staccato. And staccato then means a few different things. It can mean kind of light, short, detached, or to play in a detached manner, to complement in a connected manner. Legato, smooth, staccato. Even the way it's pronounced in some ways is indicative of what this should sound like. So staccato, can we do the exact same thing since we already have the left hand written here? The way that staccato is written, does anybody know how that's written? Or I would make the C staccato. Good, absolutely, Marcia. So C, D, E, F, G. That would make all of these light and short. Can we play the left hand like this? Okay, so starting with the fifth finger on bass C. And the way we're gonna kind of do that is, can think of an upward music, because it's kind of hot, 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 hot. Let's think of it like that, okay? There's a lot of different analogies for work. Can we try it that way? Fifth finger, left hand. One, two, ready, play. Hot, 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 hot. And you just did what every single person when they plays staccato for the first time does, and even advanced music just to do, including myself. When we played staccato, did you hear what happened to the tempo?
You should work with all eighth notes.
It went really quickly, right? Because we have that space. You have to still give these the same durational value. Because we play fast, we have all this time. What do I do with it? Oh, let's just play it faster. So we tended to rush. Can we do that one more time?
But how do you hold the half note?
You know what? Staccato can actually be for any durational value. And that's a really good question. We're going to actually get to more specific things about. There's also an infinite range between legato and staccato and how we hold. So just for this time, just think staccato is quite short. Okay? And the half note, we can write it like this for clarity. In short, to answer your question, staccato frequently is kind of considered half of the value of the note, something like that, but it's not exactly mathematical. So it's actually a really good question, but has a really complex answer. Okay, can we try it like this then? That might make it a little bit clearer. So they're all going to be the same value, and be really careful not to rush. And I'm going to subdivide for you to do that. So I'm going to give you two measures of introduction. And we're going to say, one, two, three, four, one, and two, and three, and four, and one, two, and three, and four, and one. Yeah, much better. Okay, good. So that's a little quick crash course in what articulation is, all right? So staccato, legato, these are going to be really important terms. And in the manner in which we approach the keyboard, and kind of how we play it. So you have different physical motions that will help you get these different sounds, okay? So we'll continue to work on that. For homework then, actually, I'm gonna assign something slightly different. So that exercise you guys had on page 49, can you pick, all of you pick one of them and add some articulation to it? It can either be a slur over the entire thing. It can be two notes of staccato and one of legato. And we're gonna then try to play whatever example you've written. So just write it and then you can tell me when we get here. Is that right? So everybody pick one on page 49.
Sure.
And add articulation to it. I'm gonna explore with that. So do that in addition to the dynamics that you kind of are implied with going up. Yep, the two measures, just pick one and do that. And whenever you're doing it, you can think about one. But I want you to pick one specifically and choose dynamics. Or I'm sorry, choose articulation for that.
Or two of them, you said two measures?
Yeah, so one example which comprises two measures. Yep.
I'm already in trouble.
Sure.
If I pick number two, where do I put the dot if I want that to be staccato?
That's a really good question. So you can also... What Perlis is asking is, notice how the stems go down here, I'm putting the dot on top. If you wanted to do that instead like this, the dot goes.
Okay,
so
middle C would go under if
the stem on middle C is like this, then it would go under, absolutely, yeah. Don't worry about if you mess that up, we'll get to that, but just make sure that you choose where it's at the time. But yes, that's the appropriate notation. So close to the note head and on the opposite side of the stem.
So then on the treble, you put the slur on the tongue. You put the slur on
the slurs can actually go either way, which is an interesting question. Slurs can happen. Generally, they go above, but slurs can happen actually either way. So that's a really good question. And you'll get used to it more as you see. You don't need to know this perfectly. We're not going to test you on this per se. You'll get more comfortable, but just be aware that that exists, and we'll keep putting that down on the score. So, good. All right.
I just handed back your rhythm composition. I wrote some things on it, and then on Monday we handed out a nice computer version of some of the students. We'll take a look at that on Friday. Yeah. So I just take my comments for a week. We're there. We'll keep working on rhythm and
reading
music.
Okay.
So fun working with all of you. Thanks for being here.
It's welcome.
Really fun. Oh, yeah, that's a great thing. We'll just put it back here for next time.
Kirsten, thank you for the class this morning.
And I just left to spend lots of time learning, so thank you for moving quick.
Thank you.
And getting lots of stuff.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Thank you for that feedback.
Yeah, I love it.